I am Randy Guy, President of the County Commissioners. On behalf of the County Commissioners, I want to welcome you who are here in the Great Mills High School, as well as those who are at home watching on television. Now I would like to introduce the other commissioners to you. Commissioner Tom Jarbo, representing the 1st Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George's Island. Commissioner Mike Hewitt, representing the 2nd Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown and Hollywood. Commissioner Todd Morgan, representing the 4th Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Southern California, and Great Mills. Commissioner John O'Connor, who represents the 3rd Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, and Mechanicsville, cannot be here tonight as he is attending drug prevention training, but I got him on speakerphone here. John, you're going to say something? Thank you, John. I'd also like to introduce the county staff who will assist us tonight. Dr. Rebecca Bridget, our county administrator. Jeanette Cudmore, our chief financial officer. Tony Jones, our public information officer and moderator for tonight's hearings. Bonnie Gray, our recorder tonight at the end of the table. And Amy Carter, our video meter producer, will be taking our proceeds tonight to St. Mary's County TV Channel 95, right here. For most of you who don't see us, don't be behind the glass at our commissioner's meetings. Patty Stigman and Sharon Ferris will be our timekeepers for tonight. Sharon and, where are Patty's? Oh, there's Pat, sorry, I was pretty side by side, good. Ladies and gentlemen, before you tonight is a proposed budget of $226,897,831. We remain committed to our priorities of public safety, education, and providing quality programs and services to our community. I have met with the school board chairman, Ms. Bailey, Superintendent Smith, and Sheriff Cameron. The commissioners stand ready to join the school system meeting the safety needs of all our students. Our job as county commissioners is to continue to address the needs of our community and responsible management the funds you have entrusted in us. You may have attended one of the budget work sessions at the Chesapeake Building in Leonardtown over the past few months, or watched them on St. Mary's County Channel 95, or followed them on the newspapers. Tonight is your chance to share your thoughts about the recommended budget. We should like to share your recommendation and we will consider your request. We understand and there are differences of opinions. We commissioners don't all feel the same way about each issue, but what is important is that we listen to each other and what they have to say. We ask that you respect your neighbors as they are recognized to speak tonight, whether you are here with us at Great Mills High School or watching us at home on TV. I want to remind you that our public comments period for the 4 public hearings tonight will remain open until Tuesday, April 24th. Our next budget work session is on May 1st, 2018. Finally, I would like to thank our county staff and the Great Mills High School staff for all of their efforts preparing for this hearing tonight. I would be remiss if we did not acknowledge the strength of the Great Mills High School and a community during time adversity. We are with you. We are Great Mills. We are Great Mills strong. Please join us in a moment of silence. On behalf of the commissioners, I would like to thank you for your interest and participation in this process. I will ask Jeanette Cudmore, our county financial officer, to present an overview of the proposed budget, and then our public information officer, Tony Jones, will guide us through our hearings tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. There are 4 public hearings tonight. The constant yield tax rate, The solid waste environmental fee increase, the increase in various land use and growth management permit fees, and the 2019 recommended budget. Starting with the general fund revenues, the general fund revenues for the county mainly come from property tax and income tax. Both information comes from the state on calculating. Assessment data is received in November for personal property and utilities, and real property comes in February. Income tax calendar year information comes in November, and we use the tax year 2016 receipts in developing our estimate for FY 2019. Revenues are projected to increase by 2.5%. We are required to follow guidance from the state for the constant yield tax rate. If the assessments increase, the rate goes down. County is required to hold this public hearing because the rate is not being proposed. The advertisement was included in the April 6th edition of the Enterprise in the general section. The constant yield tax rate is 0.8443, which is 0.0035 lower than the current rate of 0.8478. Adopting the constant yield tax rate would reduce the general fund operating revenues by $430,536. Included in this recommended budget are increased land use and growth management fees, approximately $140,000. User fees were last increased in 2010, and proposed increase will be effective December 1, 2018. Building permit fees were last increased in 2004, and the proposed increase will be effective July 1, 2018. These fees increases will offset increased recurring expenditures. The solid waste and recycling environmental fee was last increased 2 years ago, and proposed at that time to be a phased increase. The new fee will be $91 per dwelling and will provide additional revenue of $877,000. As you can see on this slide, the revenue has been below the blue expenditures, and the $1 million subsidy from the general fund ended in FY 2016. Actual expenditures in 2017 exceeded revenues by $466,000. Here is the summary of the expenditures for all funds. On the left-hand side, the county's operating funds are made up of the general fund, which funds the majority of the county's expenditures. Enterprise funds are self-supporting and operate like a business. The special revenue funds use dedicated resources to pay for the expenses. On the right-hand side are the other operating funds from independent boards. These are principally state paid from state funds and tuition from the College of Southern Maryland. When we develop the budget each year, we are responsible. FY 2019 continues the use of the multi-year operating budget, developed based on trends from past years for revenues and expenses, and using estimated recurring costs that will be coming in the future, such as debt service expenditures from our capital improvements projects debt capacity. Projected enrollment from the Board of Ed is used for their allocations through FY 2024. Operating impacts from capital improvement projects include approximately 80 positions for in the next 3 fiscal years for the adult detention center, the animal shelter, and the new elementary school in FY 2022. Priorities of the commissioners continue to be public education, public safety, making sure we fund maintenance of effort and keeping citizens safe, using recurring revenues for recurring expenditures, and being disciplined in the use of county reserves. As already mentioned, FY 2019 general fund budget is 2.5% more than the prior year. Debt service includes increase for planned borrowing of $30 million in FY 2019. A public hearing reserve of $153,524 is included to address additional appeals and requests after this public hearing. I wanted to highlight a few items in our recommended budget. Currently, the county departments have a net increase of 7.2 positions with the removal of the 2 positions in tourism. Tourism of the county will be transitioned to contract services. Technology and maintenance costs are also increasing. The recommended budget includes a one merit and step on the anniversary date for county employees. The Sheriff's Office total budget, including grants, is $2.1 million more than the FY 2018 and includes a vacancy reserve. Recurring funding is 2.5% higher. Along with the merit and compensation for all county government employees, their budget includes a 1% increase to the employer contribution to the Sheriff's Office retirement plan, bringing the percentage to 40%. Based on the change in official enrollment to 17,154.75 students, which is actually an increase of 27.25 students, the maintenance of effort for the Board of Education is $102.3 million. The county is adding $700,000 in recurring funds over maintenance of effort to bring the recurring funds above $103 million. County funding was requested to fund the negotiated agreements for merit and health insurance. The Board of Education will present their final budget by category to the commissioners on June 12, 2018 for approval. Additional funds over maintenance of effort are also funded to the College of Southern Maryland and the Board of Library Trustees. The College of Southern Maryland's budget is $110,076 over maintenance of effort, and the library is receiving $1.1 million over their required amount. Total funding to the Department of Health is $2.2 million. This is $1.6 million over the local required match. Other state agencies are receiving $3 million of county funds, such as alcohol beverage, elections, local, and the local state Department of Assessments. Our FY 2019 capital budget is $58.1 million. We look at multi-year capital expenditures, the impacts to the operating budget, and how the funding of capital projects impacts our debt service, which is budgeted in the operating funds. Our capital plan is below our affordability measures. Major capital improvement projects in FY 2019 include the FDR Boulevard, planned to be completed in FY 2020, Three Notch Trail, Phase 7, for $6.3 million. The Adult Detention Center upgrades housing and medical units will cost $25.9 million in the next 3 years, leveraging state funds. Park Hall and Hollywood Elementary School roof HVAC replacements are also leveraging state funds. Combined funding for these two projects in FY 2019 is $8.9 million. Two capital and improvement projects affordability ratios are reviewed. We are below the measures for both. Debt service as a percent of revenue should be below 10%. The range in the FY 2024 to FY 2024 is 5.2 to 6.06%. Debt service as a percent of assessed value should be below 2.15%. The range in the plan to FY 2024 is 1.65 to 2.07%. Plan borrowing for $30 million in FY 2019 and included for this borrowing is $555,000 for interest. The full payment will be in FY 2020. The next steps in our budget process is to consider citizen input and update any changes from the legislation session that it just ended. Public comment received through tonight through April 24th will be considered. We have a budget work session on May 1st and May 8th, and the approval is on May 15th. Tony Jones will now conduct the four hearings.
Thank you, Jeanette. Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Tony Jones, the Public Information Officer for St. Mary's County Government, and I'm also the station manager for St. Mary's County Government TV 95. Again, welcome to Great Mills High School and the fiscal year 2019 budget public hearing. I will serve as your moderator for our four scheduled hearings for this evening. As for the rules governing our hearings, I will call the name of each person who has signed up to speak. I'll also announce the following speaker. Now, that person should be prepared to step up to the microphone
once the prior speaker has concluded their remarks. Our four public hearings, as Jeanette has stated, are as follows. They are a hearing on the constant yield tax rate, a hearing on the land use and growth management revenue increase, a hearing on the proposed solid waste environmental fee increase, and finally, a hearing on the FY 2019 recommended budget. Individuals who wish to speak will have 3 minutes to make their remarks. Those representing a group or a part of a group wishing to comment on the same topic are highly recommended and encouraged to select one spokesperson, and that person will be given 5 minutes to speak. When you come up to the microphone, you must indicate that you are representing a group. Anyone else wishing to speak and are part of the same group or have a similar opinion will be given 3 minutes to speak. An electronic timer will be used and can be found on the computer screen in front of the microphone here to help speakers keep track of their time. Ms. Stigman will operate the timer. She will signal me when you have 1 minute remaining and once again when you have 30 seconds remaining. And at that point, I will alert you that your time is running out. When your time has expired, the timer will flash red, and that'll be your signal to wrap up your comments. Now, out of respect for everyone wishing to speak this evening, you're asked to please stick to the time limits. Now, whether you choose to speak or not, written comments will be accepted through Tuesday, April 24th, for consideration during budget work sessions scheduled for May 1st and May 8th. Written comments can be submitted via email, U.S. mail, or dropped off at the Office of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County in Leonardtown. Now, you know, sometimes a written letter does a better job of providing more detail than you can cover standing at the microphone in just a few moments. Only one comment of your written comments is required. Our staff will provide additional comments, additional copies, to the commissioners. We will work to ensure everyone is given a chance to speak. Now at 9 o'clock, because there's a lot of people here this year, unlike last year, at 9 o'clock, if we still have a number of speakers awaiting their turn, we're gonna take a short break and return to complete the list. Now this evening's proceedings are being televised live on St. Mary's County Government TV 95 on Metrocast Cable, and they're streaming live as well on the Channel 95 webpage. If you should miss any portion of our hearings, they will re-air this weekend on Saturday, April 21st, and again on Sunday, April 22nd. The video will also be posted to the county's YouTube channel, as well as to the St. Mary's County Government TV 95 Facebook page. Now, as a reminder, this is a convened meeting of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, and the rules of order for St. Mary's County boards and commissions is in effect. You are asked to address your comments directly to the commissioners and not to members of the audience. And that said, I now open the first public hearing for comments on the constant yield tax rate. First speaker of the evening, Keith Harless. Following Mr. Harless is going to be Clark Guy.
Go ahead. Okay. Good evening, County Commissioners. My name is Keith Harless. I'm 23225 Murfield Lane, Lexington Park, Maryland. On the constant yield, we the citizens would like to see a constant yield. We understand our assessments go up about 3% each year, so you're keeping the rate up, and we're going to get an additional assessment. Every year I get to pay more. All of us get to pay more. So it's a constant yield in your pockets, but it's not in ours. And so how do we address some of this? Well, one, been very soft on the impact fee, although you are doing something which is different than in the past. But you're still way under what the fee needs to be. It's not going up fast enough. It's not going up enough. It's still way under. It's less than half of what is being incurred for the cost. So I'd like to see the impact fee come up even more. And then we have the jobs growth portion of the property tax, where if they create jobs, I understand that they're supposed to get a property tax cut as to encourage that. And yet we have a situation where a property owner didn't create any jobs, so they wouldn't be eligible for it. The company leasing the property created jobs, but they don't own the property, so they logically would not be eligible for it. And yet there's still discussion about giving them money. And so if you start down this road where you're just going to be giving away money, even though it doesn't meet the requirements, even doesn't meet the reasons, I mean, last year you set, you know, a 40-year limit for property cuts.
1 minute.
For elderly, you know, and 40 years is very onerous, and it's just too long of time for the elderly. And so, you know, I'm not going to just go back and just say, well, you didn't meet the 40 years, you get the money anyways. And that's kind of what you're doing if you go down that road. You know, people who aren't qualified should not get the property tax cut. And there are other ways to incentivize income, creating jobs. Income tax is another one, so that people that fall into this category, if you want to give them some incentive. So there are other ways of doing it, but I definitely would like to see the constant yield tax imposed at the lower rate, and to make up some of that difference, impose higher impact fee. Thank you.
Clark Guy.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you wouldn't mind, would you speak closer into the microphone, because we can't hear you now, or adjust the microphone to your mouth. Mr. Guy.
Thank you, Commissioner Morgan. So as a candidate, I really didn't want to speak publicly or criticize your budget decisions or your process. I know you have a big job, and I really do appreciate everything that you guys do. I didn't want to be a distraction. I do respect the position that you guys are placed in. However, as a tax-paying citizen, I do have a few things that I'd like to discuss. One, we know that for the past few years, there has been a fund balance, a surplus, over and over, and you continue to add to that reserve. We also know that due to the state's inaction over this last legislative session, we are going to pay more in income tax. We know this. We know these things now. We know these things now to be true. We know that their property taxes is almost 50% of our county's budget, yet we continue to have a fund balance. So, gentlemen, in light of all this, I would like to see our property tax rate adjusted below the constant yield rate. It's my understanding that the fund balance or the surplus for this year is $30 million. There are approximately 46,000 property taxpayers in this county. That comes out to about $700 per property taxpayer. We can cut that in half knowing that, you know, it's only 50% or almost 50% of it, so $350. Gentlemen, if you're not going to adjust the property tax constant yield below the constant yield, I'd like to have my $350 back. Or I want to say and what it's spent on.
1 minute.
You took $350 of hard-earned taxpayer money, and if I don't get it back, I'd like equal portions of it to be spent on education, as is in our plan. The sheriff's office has is also a priority in the plan, and on our first responders in the emergency management department, including our fire and rescue volunteers. Again, I thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I do appreciate you. God bless you.
Mr. Guy is the last person to have signed up. If there's anyone else who would like to speak on the constant yield tax rate, please step up to the microphone. All right, I will close that portion of the hearing for this evening. And I now open the public hearing on the proposed land use and growth management revenue increase. I have no speakers signed up for that hearing. If anybody wishes to speak on that, please step up to the microphone. Seeing none, we'll close that hearing out. And now open the public hearing on the proposed solid waste environmental fee increase. And again, I'm not showing anybody signed up to speak on that. If anybody would like to speak, now would be the time to do so. All right. All right, now to the main event. I now open the public hearing on the fiscal year 2019 recommended budget. And we will get to that. Let me get to that page and start calling names. First up, ironically enough, Scott Smith. Following Mr. Smith. That's the most applause I've heard anybody from in all the years I've done this. Following Mrs. Smith is going to be Liz Purcell Leskinen. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, and thank you for everybody coming out this evening. Good evening. On behalf of the Board of Education, the employees, the students, the parents of St. Mary's County Public Schools, I make the following remarks. Your public schools have never needed you more. We need your support. We need your financial support. While the 0.8% increase in funding proposed will allow us to honor our negotiated agreement for over 2,000 employees, it will not move the school system forward. It will not expand instructional programs or provide additional support for staff or improve communication with our community or allow us alternatives for struggling students who are challenging our secondary schools. It will not move school safety forward or meet the rising need for behavioral and mental health we see in our schools and across our community. It will widen the gap between our per pupil allocation and the Maryland state average. That gap is currently $1,399 per student. If we were funded at the state average per pupil allocation, we would have an additional $24 million recurring to spend on our students. We ask that you provide the funds requested, a 2% recurring increase over last year's funding. We need you to stand up for our schools, as you have for law enforcement and local government and our libraries. Education is the greatest investment we can make because it unlocks opportunity. And opportunity is the expectation of our children and their parents. We must stand together to give them the future they deserve. Thank you very much.
Now is Liz Leskinen, and following Ms. Leskinen is Courtney Town.
Good evening. My name is Liz Purcell Leskinen, and I live in Leonardtown. I am here tonight to talk about public education. Public education is an investment. It is not an expense. Public education is a worthy investment one with immense social and economic benefits. St. Mary's County can invest now, or we can pay later. Investing now is far more cost-effective than paying for the social and economic consequences of underfunded, low-quality schools. People who graduate with a quality education are more likely to find gainful employment, more likely to have stable families, and more likely to be active and productive citizens. They are less likely to commit serious crimes, less likely to place high demands on other county services, and less likely to be enrolled in welfare assistance programs. I invest in our public schools 365 days a year as a voter, as a taxpayer, and as a public school advocate. Contrary to the assertions of some, this is not just a job for me. It's my value system. It's my heritage. St. Mary's County Public Schools has 2,000 such dedicated employees who invest in education day in and day out, despite the political quibbling, despite the shortage of resources, despite the safety concerns, despite the sometimes disrespectful discourse, despite the low pay for the required level of skill and education, and despite the rigorous demands. These employees vote, they pay taxes, they show up for our students every single day of the week. And if that's not enough, many of them had to show up here tonight instead of trusting their elected officials to get it done. I'm going to ask all past and public educators here tonight to stand. Beautiful. We understand commitment. We understand responsibility. We understand investment. We don't understand why the Board of Education of St. Mary's County has to be insulted, chastised, jibbed and jabbed just to support safe and successful schools. We don't understand why this cannot be a dignified and respectful process. Please honor our staff, honor our students, and honor our community. Provide the $3 million to totally fund the Board of Education's reduced, respectful, and responsible budget request. Please invest in public education. St. Mary's County can afford it. St. Mary's County deserves it. Thank you for your service.
Courtney Town, and following Courtney will be Rufus Mitchell.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. This is my 16th year as a school counselor in St. Mary's, 11 years at Margaret Brent, with 5 in the middle at Dinard Elementary. I have read that some of you believe our budget is extravagant. That is far from the truth. We have been working with the bare minimum for years. Now we are in trouble because we need something more. This is not the same community I started in. My school is not the same place I've known. We have arrived at a place where schools need to do more than provide an education. We are providing food, clothing, holiday gifts, therapy, and for some students, the only stable adult support they have. Schools are a one-stop shop for some of our most vulnerable children. Children are coming to school with trauma, grief, and fears that often contribute to behavior. Currently in Maryland, we're encouraged to use suspension sparingly and instead provide interventions for students who don't meet the expectations for behavior. These types of behavior interventions take time to be effective. We're charged with keeping the most challenging students in the building. But who's going to provide these interventions and with what time? The additional requested money includes 2 counselor positions and security personnel. Charles County and Calvert County Public Schools have school psychologists who meet regularly with kids, and Calvert also has social workers to assist families, in addition to school counselors to handle the daily issues. We have no social workers, and our psychologists and PPWs are spread so thin that most schools only use them for consultation and testing. We are struggling to even fully staff our middle schools with counselors. Margaret Brent and Esperanza have two counselors each for student populations of 1,000. That is 500 students per counselor, twice the recommended ratio of 250 to 1. I do not need to discuss the need for secure buildings. I believe that point is unfortunately all too clear. While I understand that you don't determine how the school system spends their money, you do determine if we are able to provide a safe school environment. We should not have to choose to fund either the academic education of our kids or the behavior and emotional supports for discipline and security of our buildings. This budget must be fully funded. Thank you.
Rufus Mitchell, and following Mr. Mitchell will be Chloe Grant.
So when I originally heard I had the opportunity to speak to you guys, I was going to go home and write like an amazing essay on why schools should be funded, but I felt like that wasn't the right thing to do. I felt like I should come up here and be genuine with you guys and give you guys my honest opinion on how things feel. I'm up here talking to you guys today not out of frustration, but more out of concern for St. Mary's County Public Schools in the future. I'd argue that education is probably the most important thing for St. Mary's County. Not only has funding for St. Mary's County given me certain programs that has helped me to achieve the part that I'm at and helped me grow as a human, it has also led me to be able to meet great people and have more than just a family at home. Hearing the fact that education is one of the lowest things funded, it genuinely scared me, knowing that the people who want us to succeed in life are the ones not funding us as much so that we can succeed. That is not a direct attack at you, it's just honestly the way that I feel, and I'm sorry if that's how it came off. I would also like to say that I would also like to say that the programs that the funding has honestly given me, such as theater and sports, have, like I've said, led us to be better people and led us to grow as humans. One thing that I realized when it comes to when you don't fund education is that it's a trickle-down effect. Not only are you not funding schools, you're also making it so that teachers aren't being paid enough. And when teachers aren't being paid enough, they do not want to work as hard, leading to students who aren't having the education that they deserve. And what that leads to, it also leads to our future, the future of St. Mary's County. The students that are in school aren't getting the education that they do deserve. And it is honestly an honor to be able to speak to all of you and be able to stand in front of all of you and speak my mind, and I honestly do appreciate this opportunity. Thank you.
Chloe Grant, and following Chloe will be Skylar Heppner.
Good evening. I am Chloe Grant, and I am here on behalf of Rave House Productions at Choptagon High School to discuss the funding for education, specifically for programs such as the Academy of Visual and Performing Arts. To be frank, the Board of Education needs to find more opportunities to subsidize for their arts in schools. In current standing, Rave House raises every penny that we have, like other theater departments and schools, while other extracurricular activities are mostly subsidized by the school systems. How can we expect to have a thriving academy if we don't receive the same amount of support as other activities? The arts influences students in every way. It gives students a voice. Dancers tested better in memory and motion processing than non-dancers. Musicians demonstrated better auditory visual discrimination and oral recognition than non-musicians. Drama activities improve reading comprehension and both verbal and nonverbal communication skills. But the benefits reach further than education. Drama brings light to mental health issues. Theater activates higher levels of personal strengths, such as self-esteem, self-confidence, strengthening of identity, and being able to be a part of a group. These aspects stick with students throughout their lives. Think of it this way. Decreasing funding for schools, you are taking the opportunity for us to grow, not as students, but as human beings. By supporting these programs, you are supporting not only education and growth, but the education and growth for future students. With the constant growth of interest in theater, Brave House grows in number. the schools, the arts just grow in number, and without the proper funding, we are not able to grow in ways that benefit all the students involved. As the Board of Education puts it, education is an investment, not an expense. If you invest in the students, you invest in the future. So invest in us. Thank you.
Skylar Heppner, and following Skylar will be Deb D'Imperio.
Hello, I am a student at Chopticon, and that is home to Academy of Visual Performing Arts. And I would like to ask for a dance program for AVPA. Before my freshman year, I decided to audition for that, and it was slowly taken away from me due to lack of funding. At Chopticon, we have multiple students who participate in dance after school, and many of them wanted to participate in the dance academy. If we had a teacher for the dance program, it would be less money out of the students/teachers' pockets to pay for a choreographer. For at Brave House, we are barely able to buy plays and musicals we perform. But if we had a dance program at Chopticon, it would complete the puzzle piece of the Academy of Visual Performing Arts. Dance is that visual performance that is missing from AVPA. Having a dance program at Chopticon would help many individuals express themselves in a way that's different than theater. For some people are scared to speak in front of a crowd, but they can dance no problem. As a student, I wish you would consider funding this program. And if not, then I encourage you to give more funding towards the arts in general, because that's where many students thrive. A diverse and well-rounded community should include all facets of the arts. As a senior who has seen Brave House grow tremendously since freshman year, I would personally just like to see my theater, which I call home, taken care of. Thank you.
Okay, Deb D'Imperio, and following Deb will be Tammy Grant.
Here today with Chopticon Brave House. My name's Deb D'Imperio, and I just wanted to tell you that these kids are amazing, right? We're so impressed with them. I needed to come here to talk to you tonight about their funding, and the first thing I thought of was their paintbrushes, and I'd like my daughter to hand you their paintbrushes. She's going to bring them to you, because the last time I volunteered, I couldn't believe somebody could make a paintbrush be a nub like this. From such hard work. I don't know where you could buy this type of paintbrush anymore. I don't think they make it. I'm probably saying maybe from the 70s, I don't know. So I went to Hobby Lobby and I bought new paintbrushes and I put your names on them, county commissioners, and I put the date. So we're gonna stay right there, sweetie. We need those paintbrushes back. I just wanted to say these kids can do so much with so little. The teachers in this county, I've been here 20 years, I've been a parent, a volunteer, and an employee in St. Mary's County, and with resources where they were parsing out paper to the teachers, you've got kids that are amazing, and they're so well-mannered, and this particular program, if you ever go there, I highly recommend it. There's no phones. There's no bullying. There's just this beautiful family of kids that deserve to get represented. And St. Mary's County having a visual performing academy is so forward thinking, because do you have a favorite song? Does everybody up here have a favorite song? Yeah, or a favorite play? Imagination leads to innovation, and St. Mary's County can lead us as a country when we need to maybe have more love, more acceptance, and definitely, you know, just more art. So, did we get the paintbrushes back? Okay, great. I'd love for this to be the first of many paintbrushes that you guys provide to St. Mary's County. Thank you for your time.
Tammy Grant, and following Tammy will be Brianna Limerice.
Good evening. My name is Tammy Grant, and I'm the president with Brave House Boosters at Choptank High School. But tonight I'm here as a parent who is concerned for her child's education. As a Board of Education puts it, education is an investment, not an expense. The Board of Education was told to plan for a 2% increase in their budget. It only received a 0.5% increase. Meanwhile, I've read that Circuit Court received almost an 8% increase in budget. I have looked over the percentage increase received by the Office of the Sheriff and the Emergency Services, and I understand their need. But I wonder what the benefits would come from taking a portion of that budgeted money from the circuit courts and putting it into the education and bringing it back to investing in our children now rather than later. Thank you.
Brianna Maurice, and following Brianna will be Karen Myers.
Good evening. My name is Brianna Maurice. I would like to bring attention to the high schools in our county. Choptank High School, home of the Academy of Visual and Performing Arts. Great Mills High School, home of STEM. Leonardtown High School, home of GIS, Global International Studies. All of these are specific things that tend to the needs each student likes. If a student wants to join that program, he or she can learn about that topic and grow in it so that they can do something hopefully with it in their career, with the rest of their life. Students can go to that school even if it's out of their district because they solely want to go and to learn about that subject. Without the funding to go to our schools, to go to those programs, students can't improve on their future. They can't continue to grow. They will stay where they are, and that's what our future will be, students who haven't improved. As I conclude, I would like to bring attention to the fact that multiple students have come here tonight to talk about saving their education, and it's pretty disappointing how they feel the need to do that instead of trusting that money will go to them to help them improve. Thank you.
Karen Myers, and following Karen will be Dr. Janice Wolfhauer.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Karen Myers, and this is my 19th year of teaching. I can say without hesitation that I love my job. I love seeing my students come in each day ready to learn. Without a doubt, I can say that I picked the best job. But it's hard to look at their faces and know that as a teacher, I cannot give them the education that they deserve. We have classes that have students more students than one teacher can handle. Special education teachers with caseloads that are unmanageable. Students with emotional and psychological needs that we do not have the staff to meet. Schools with disruptive students, and there is no funding for programs to productively affect change for these students. Schools without the technology needed to compete in today's society, and teachers that do not have what is needed for supplies of daily instruction. Year after year, we are faced with all of these difficulties, and we are told to do our jobs without the necessary tools and equipment. We are told to do with less. Not giving the Board of Education the money they need for our schools is disrespectful to the teachers, the support staff, and the students, all of whom will be voters in this county. For years, people have retired and their positions have not been filled due to the lack of funding. However, there are still need. These jobs have been passed on to other people who already have too much to do on their plate. Every year, teachers have to figure out how to teach with less. But there is a breaking point. Although we might think that we are superheroes, we cannot add more time to the day. There are only 7.5 hours that we are able to give our jobs done, and the more that you put on us, the less we are able to work with our students. I am asking you to think about your choices. Did you say? say time?
1 minute.
Oh, sorry. Think about the children. These children need reasonable class sizes so that every child can learn. Counselors need to be there to help children when they have crisis. To access the necessary equipment and to learn, the teachers need to have time to plan. They need to have time to work with the kids. These kids are the future. Please do not skimp on their educational needs. Respect the process, respect the citizens, respect the staff and the students. Fund the superintendent's original budget, and please give us the money that we need to effectively teach our students. Thank you.
Dr. Janice Walthour, and following Dr. Walthour will be Steve Chadwick.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm speaking on behalf of a group, St. Mary's County NAACP.
5 minutes granted.
3 years ago, I stood before you representing the NAACP and shared the two of our priorities that as an organization at the local, state, and county levels are economic sustainability and education. Our county continues to be one of the fastest growing counties in the state, yet income disparities continue to exist for thousands of residents. Many have jobs, perhaps two or more, but incomes remain low while cost of living gets higher. We have wealth for many of our citizens, but there is a portion or a population known as the working poor who are still struggling to be included in the wealth. Education is the key for moving our citizens forward, and we are speaking out for the elimination of these economic disparities, which in many cases lead to educational achievement gaps that exist in our county and directly impact the minority populations and citizens that are low socioeconomic, the population. The demand is clearly the need for paying people a living wage. These disparities do impact equal opportunities for access to education, health care, and employment. We know that there are solutions, that we have worked with the school system and CSM to open the doors of the tech center for opportunities for training and certification. We have just come out of a nightmare after the shooting at Great Mills right here at this school, which resulted in the injury of one and the death of two young people. School safety is at the forefront of many minds, but the issue that sparked this tragedy is one caused by a social-emotional crisis for a teenager who had access to a semi-automatic gun. Our community must have the heart and generosity to support all of our children, especially those whose parents may not know or have the wherewithal or motivation to act as responsible parents in the home or in their connection with the school. It is not the child's fault. Some children have nowhere else to go but to school for this support and guidance. Funding the positions and resources needed in the Board of Education's budget request, in my opinion, would not be a knee-jerk reaction to a horrific tragedy. These are jobs, positions that are sorely needed in our schools. Plus, you have the added opportunity of providing more jobs for our citizens. And none of these are administrative positions. Our schools today are in need of more human services to help children succeed in life. Schools are in the business of producing people who will lead our communities. These positions provide people who will embrace diversity, provide for the social, emotional, and career development of our children, and open opportunities for more communication with parents and the community. So please fund the request. There's a human resources workforce diversity coordinator. Previous positions have been in the budget, but it's the first to be cut to support many other needs. Okay, let's look at some of those jobs were doled out to administrators, and everybody's job becomes nobody's job when it comes to diversity and inclusion, social emotional support. Student resources, the evening high school is needed, the High Roads program to support those students at risk of not graduating. Guidance counselors, they're only asking for two. that supports the social-emotional development of students. Safety and security assistance, I don't have to speak to that, not standing here in Great Mills High School. Building service workers, that's employment. Three people could be employed just if you pass this budget. Also, the floating school secretary to mentors, once again, jobs for people. The junior, the ROTC instructor, once again, student development, career development. Webmasters to support communication, more communication in the schools. And textbooks and furniture. These are the things that are needed to keep our community safe, to keep our students active and productive. And we're also here to support that community youth center. Thank you so much for including it in the budget. It's coming up, we know, in 2022, but I can't leave this microphone without saying we need it now. Thank you.
Steve Chadwick, and following Mr. Chadwick will be Dwayne Hancock.
Hello, commissioners. I'm here, Steve Chadwick, and also speaking for the Safe Schools Initiative, if that can be recognized as a group as well.
Okay, 5 minutes granted.
Thank you. Commissioners, educators, parents here tonight, I've seen the priorities about education and safety, and I'm here to tell you the two are not mutually exclusive. Secure all facilities for education now. Of all the topics tonight, that's the most important, as I have my arm around my daughter right now. Huntingtown, 2006, guns and weapons were found. 12 years ago, a shooting was prevented, and yet Great Mills happened. 12 years later, we have vestibules and we have cameras, yet Great Mills happened. We had a school safety forum the day after Parkland, yet Great Mills happened. We had a second one with costs and with other ideas that were dismissed as difficult. Great Mills happened. And then, Great Mills happened. Since then, asked for special budget hearings or sessions for school safety, not gotten responses to date. Then the Safe to Learn Act was passed, but it only gives resource officers to schools that didn't have them. Great Mills did, and lockable classroom doors. What else needs to happen? What? Now is the time to comprehensively safe our schools. Sandy Hook was rebuilt with ballistic glass. Parkland, unauthorized access to the school. Columbine, Great Mills, Parkland. SROs were there. The shootings happened anyway. Birmingham, Alabama, just before Parkland, the day the metal detectors were off, a gun came into the school. Red Lake, Minnesota, 2005, individual went to the detectors and there were unarmed guards. You can Google it to see what happened. In each case, some aspect of these comprehensive ABCs of school safety were not there. Only through the comprehensive implementation of those can we have some degree of ease that it won't happen again in our community. Who does have these comprehensive measures, though? Congress does. NAS Patuxent River does. The Leonardtown Courthouse does. You know where else has them? The Smithsonian Museum. So we can have priceless artifacts, but apparently our children aren't as priceless. We claim to be Maryland's first. I see it all the time in St. Mary's County. Enough. Let's be first. Fund and implement these comprehensive ABCs now. Parents are willing to chip in more, do grants. I've done this before. My weekly McDonald's money is right here. I've left it on the stage before. I'll leave it on the stage again tonight. I'm willing to offer it as a parent. I won't speak for everybody. I'm only speaking for myself and the initiative. We'll volunteer. Let's do a referendum. Let's put a bond measure. It doesn't matter. I'll close with this. Fiscal matters are difficult. We all have to prioritize. We all understand that just from living our day-to-day lives. I'm not sure what's more important than keeping our kids safe at school back to the safe public education. So after tonight, think about this. Whatever obstacle there may be to get this done, is that worth more than Kimberly Dennis's son? Is it worth more? Is it more important than my daughter here beside me right now? Is it harder or more important than Jalen Willie's life? Think about that. What I'll tell my daughter, what you look at your children and grandchildren and tell them when you had the opportunity to implement the comprehensive ABCs of school safety, think about those things and act accordingly. Thank you.
Dwayne Hancock, and following Mr. Hancock will be Jamie Connors.
Good evening, County Commissioners, students, educators, parents, and community members. Maintenance of effort has been met each of the last 4 years because it has to, it's the law. The law also requires the superintendent to request a budget that reflects the needs of the school system. I know 3% is a lot for most counties, but for the sixth richest county in the state of Maryland, it should be easy. St. Mary's County ranks sixth in wealth, but 19th in per pupil spending. The investment in education is important because students are our future. The students need their commissioners to fund a budget that adds safety and security, workers, counselors, psychologists, teachers, building service workers, paras, maintenance staff, and many other support positions. These staff members provide structure, care, and support for our students, emotional well-being, as well as safe, warm, clean learning environments that help with their physical needs for learning. I know the important role that education plays in society, and I hope that you will recognize the need to increase the FY19 school system budget. Thank you.
Jamie Connors, and following Ms. Connors will be Angela Gosk.
Hello. Thank you for allowing me to speak today and share my concerns with you. My name is Jamie Connors, and I'm a third-year teacher at St. Mary's County Public Schools. I'm here to advocate for our children and ask for more funding from the county commissioners. Benjamin Franklin once said that an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. Though there are many concerns I have with the welfare of education, I bring to you the concerns I have with teacher resources and support. This year alone, I have seen numerous colleagues leave the teaching profession to work elsewhere because of the stress the field of education can cause and the lack of support that we're given. I have wanted to teach since I was 5 years old, when my parents turned our old shed into a schoolhouse with a chalkboard and desks. I have so much passion for what I do, but all the passion in the world cannot change the fact that we do not have enough support. We need more counselors. We need more safety officers in our schools. My school shares our safety officer with another school. So there are times that that officer is not there. This is a huge safety concern that heightens the fear in our school. In the few years that I've been with St. Mary's County Public Schools, I've seen the drastic change in our children and in our classrooms. Many are coming to us with numerous hardships. We need your financial support so that we can reach each child. Before you make your final decision, I challenge you to come into our classrooms. I invite you into my room. Come in and see the responsibilities that I take on, the obstacles that myself and my colleagues face. See the children that I work with each and every day. Ask me where all of my resources in my classroom came from, and I'll tell you that I personally paid for them. So my room can feel like a little bit of home.
1 minute.
If you can tell me that we can adequately improve the lives of our youth with the resources that we have, I'll say okay. But once you come into my room and you see my kids and the things that I deal with every day, really tell me, am I making the biggest impact that I can? Is that five-year-old little girl who had that dream to make an impact doing her job? Thank you very much.
Angela Gosk, and following Angela will be Carol Bolden.
Good evening. My name is Angie Goska, and I'm a special education paraeducator at Leonardtown Middle, and I live in Leonardtown. I am also the current treasurer for ESMIC. I appreciate and understand the importance of and the difficulty in creating a budget that meets all the needs of the various departments in the county. I support sixth grade math, science, and social studies at LMS, and I have about 10 students in each class of 22 to 27 students who have documented special needs, such as an IEP or a 504, and therefore require a lot of attention. At LMS, which has an enrollment of nearly 1,000 students, with approximately 150 who have special education services or support of a paraeducator in the classroom, that's nearly 15% of our enrollment. I personally often find it difficult to effectively meet all of the needs of the students and the teachers whom I support, both helping to provide the accommodations and interventions that are required by the IEPs and 504s, and collecting data, as well as assisting and supporting students who may be struggling but don't have documented special education requirements. I love my job, and I am a committed and dedicated employee. With a salary of less than $22,000 a year, I am not in this for the money, but to be able to make a positive contribution to the lives of the children I support. I know that I am not alone in feeling that more special education staff is needed in order to effectively meet the needs of our students. Not only are we far short in resources and the number of paraeducators in the district, we are vastly undervalued for the potential of positive impact we make on a child's ability to access curriculum and be successful. According to the 2018 Health and Human Services Guidelines, the poverty level for a family of four is $25,100. Paraeducator 1 positions in this district start at $20,584, and paraeducator 2 positions who are highly qualified start at $21,837. Both are required to have a minimum of 2 years college and must pass a practice exam. It is my understanding that in May 2017, the Commission indicated that SMCPS Board of Education could expect a 2% increase in funding. Why then does this current budget reflect an increase of less than 1%? This doesn't feel like a priority to me. At this current level, the currently negotiated agreement contract with employees may not be honored, and there are many serious needs of the district that cannot be met. When will this commission begin to see education as an investment rather than an expense? If we are able to effectively educate our students in a properly funded public school system, won't that be better for our community in the future and likely reduce the emotional and financial cost of other services? Please carefully consider this when finalizing the budget. I know that I cannot support a candidate who refuses to prioritize education, so I will carefully consider the actions of this commission when I cast my vote.
Carol Bolden, and following Carol will be Keith Harless. Before you go, we just want to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of St. Mary's County Sheriff Tim Cameron, who has joined us this evening.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to all of you this evening. My name is Carol Bolvin, and for the past 18 years, I have been actively involved with St. Mary's County Public Schools as a parent volunteer, substitute, and employee. I currently am employed by SMCPS as the secretary to the principal at Hollywood Elementary School. I would like to speak to you tonight regarding my concern over your rejection of the school system's 2% increase in funding for the 2019 fiscal year. Over the past 10 years, school secretary turnover has been on the rise. Since 2007, there have been 136 school secretary vacancies, nearly 50% of which have only been within the last 3 years. School administrators and staff have been hit hard by this, as they have had to wait for new support staff to be hired, get up to speed on SMCPS policy, and learn school building practices, and also learned how to do their job. The problem is that secretaries are entering into these new positions with very little or no training. This is concerning, particularly since school secretaries are responsible for managing money, maintaining accurate school records for the state, working with payroll and human resources, and numerous other sensitive and confidential matters. If funding were to be made available, a position could be created which would offer secretaries policy and procedure training, dedicated mentoring, and ongoing support. It would provide a central point of contact for consistent, clear, and reliable communications as questions regarding our job responsibilities arise and changes in procedures occur. Practices and procedures aside, there's also a lack of software training for secretarial staff. Out of the 11 software applications that I need to use to fulfill my job responsibilities, I have received on-the-job training on less than half of them. For the others, I have taught myself or sought out help from peers, eventually learning enough to get by. Sadly, I am not the only secretary who has experienced this, and frankly, this is unacceptable. We need training, not later, not eventually, but now. There is too much at risk to have so many of us undertrained. By approving the proposed funding increase, we could begin providing software training specifically tailored to the responsibilities of the secretarial staff. Secretaries are a valuable asset at SMCPS, providing us with the necessary personnel who can train and support and mentor us cannot be accomplished unless you provide the funds to make it possible. A 2% increase in funding could support the addition of a secretary trainer slash mentor position and provide this sector of the workforce with the training and support we so critically need. Thank you for your consideration.
Keith Harless, following Mr. Harless will be Robin Tate.
Good evening, Keith Harless, Lexington Park. I'd like to talk about some of the other groups, especially the fire department, rescue squad, EMS. Thank you for your support and hope to increase support for them. I can tell you over the years, I can hear them from when they leave one of the squads close to my home. Definitely has been an increase in calls. You can definitely tell that over the years. They have to deal with so many more things than we used to. The opioid crisis, like the sheriff's department is another group that increased number of calls. Everyone has more responsibilities, more issues. The jail and fully funding that and the staffing that that's going to require. The traffic issues. I don't think I have to tell anybody who drives on the roads here in St. Mary's County. Every evening I think I see an accident. And the distracted drivers, and there's just, we need more support out there for those folks. The animal shelter. The animal shelter is much needed and will require staffing, and that is something that we definitely need here in the county, and we definitely will support. As well as more activity opportunities for our youth. So definitely community center, not even just one, because I mean that then creates access issues. So I'd like to see multiple in various parts of the county to serve all of the citizens, of all the youth of the county. Also would like to talk about maintaining the reserve fund and being very cautious with that. Savings is a good thing. We have unexpected natural disasters that occur. You have breakages of HVAC systems in schools that you don't expect and you know are unplanned. You have fires in facilities that's occurred in the past. These things happen, so you need that extra cushion to be able to handle these things. So I would say stay the course and follow the guidelines you already have in place and be a very cautious about draining that fund. And thank you very much.
Robin Tate. Following Mr. Tate will be Michael Blackwell.
Thank you. Gentlemen, I'd like to start off by saying it's an honor to have you here, and it's also a privilege that I have, again, the opportunity to speak with all of you. Our current situation throughout the whole school system is deplorable. We need stronger structure. We need a firm grounding of those structures. The sad thing about the situation that had happened previously should have never had happened. And we need to take action. We need to find a better way to secure the children that go to school. For all of the teachers, parents, the whole staff of the school system, they're very aware and they understand what needs to be done. Gentlemen, I'm asking one small favor. I implore that you please, all of you, understand that we are a hard-working, strong-minded, family is what I can say. All of us are family. And we all come together as a family. We need to make sure that our family is cohesive, firm, and strong. And most importantly, today, of all days, it's amazing that we can come here together in this place, in this wonderful school, and to be able to speak frankly. I don't make that much money. I'm a building service worker. I work for Esperanza. It's a great school. All of these school systems are great. Wonderful teachers, faculty, staff, from the upper management all the way down to me. I do my part because these children need our support. The teachers need funding. The maintenance need funding. The building service workers need funding. I thank you all for listening, and I hope you'll do the right thing. Thank you.
Michael Blackwell, and following Michael will be Galen Brown.
Good evening. I am speaking for a group this evening, St. Mary's County Library. I'm the director of St. Mary's County Library. Thank you so much for the chance to speak here. We're going to change the tone just a little bit, although stick with the general theme of education. I've actually come to thank you this evening. In a time of obviously sort of very scarce resources, you did give us a $30,000 increase in our materials, and that's going to go towards more digital resources. E-books have increased in use over the past year by 25%, our digital audiobooks by 90%. St. Mary's County is clearly getting online and investigating resources. A few facts about your library. Fact number one, every person in St. Mary's County on average visits the library over 5 times a year. On average, every citizen of St. Mary's County from birth through seniors check out 14 items per year. What does this cost the citizens of St. Mary's County in state funding and county funding? $2.67 a month. That runs the whole library, everything. So what do you get for $2.67 a month? Well, first of all, programs for pre-K, where young kids from age 2 months on come in, learn valuable literacy skills with their parents, get exposed to reading, STEM programs, hands-on learning, a homework help service. Students can submit an English paper online, get critiqued. Students, well, let's say their parents, can log in, get help with that math homework that many parents find very challenging. Computer access for people who don't have computers themselves, don't have a smartphone. We do have plenty of people in St. Mary's County where the digital divide is real. So for $2.67, you're getting a lot. In fact, for every dollar spent on a public library, you get at least a $5 return. Yes, you pay our salaries. That goes right back into the community. The library itself gets services and supplies from the community. We then also are giving materials. So if you come in, you check out one item a month, and you've only paid $2.67, how much are you saving per item? Libraries are great anchors. We attract people who come to the county or come to the areas in the county where the library is and spend money. So I know this is a tough time financially, but I wanted to thank you for your continued support of libraries. They are an incredible investment. Thank you so much.
Galen Brown. Galen here. All right, we'll move to the next person. That would be David Randall. And following David will be Sandra Out.
Good evening, County Commissioners. David Randall. I live in Great Mills. I'm a retired Navy captain, and I teach here at Great Mills as the head NJROTC instructor. I do not envy your position. You have some difficult decisions to make tonight. I empathize with you because I used to be a budget guy. When I was on active duty, I ran the budget for Navy and Air and Marine aircraft readiness. Each year, I'd get a little under $8 billion. And if I funded everything that people told me was a requirement, it would come to almost $10 billion. Where am I supposed to find that money? I don't have a briefcase full of cash underneath my desk. See, I had some difficult decisions to make. You have some things that you absolutely have to fund, and for the remainder, you pick the items that give you the best return on investment. And I would tell you that education is one of those items. I just take a look at my own program. I've got 170 teenagers for two teachers. And we do uniform issue, we do full admin support, everything for them. And we also run cybersecurity competitions, land navigation competitions, academic brain brawls, community service events. I'm gone more than a dozen weekends every school year just in support of my kids. I'm stretched really thin, and I'm stretched beyond the staffing limits that are in the contract between county schools and the Department of the Navy. My program provides three things, three S's. We provide structure to kids who don't get it at home. We teach the value of service. Even tonight, I had 22 teenagers out there working the track meet, not participating in it, but working it. And I also have the third S, scholarships. Out of all the seniors at Great Mills High School, I've got about 8% of them as my students, and yet every year, the dollar value of scholarships for my students is higher than the rest of the school put together. I ask you, please do not imperil the relationship between county schools and the Department of the Navy. That's the economic engine that drives this county. It provides those high-tech jobs, those engineering jobs, those cybersecurity jobs. And I ask you, if you want those high-tech jobs that are St. Mary's County's future, if you want those jobs to be filled by people who grew up in St. Mary's County, please fully fund the superintendent's budget. Thank you for your time.
Sandra Out, and following Sandra will be Sarah Penrod.
Hello there, how are you doing? Can't believe you've asked an Italian mom to summarize in 3 minutes. I don't know what Italian mom can summarize in 3 minutes, but I'm gonna try.
As a concerned parent and a taxpaying citizen, I have the expectation of when my child enters school, he is going to be safe and his academic needs will be met. I expect that when a student who may have needs which exceed what can be met in the classroom will be recognized. The school would need adequate staff to manage those needs. Based on our countywide discipline plan, we need extra funding for counselors and school resource officers to be successful. Not only for the students that with needs, but for every student in our community. I'm gonna get personal here. My son is a student. He's a sixth grade student at Margaret Brent Middle School. We go to church 3 times a week and he's in a loving home. My son is exhibiting anxiety attacks and has to leave class to be able to breathe because of the disruptions in the classroom. He does not know this behavior or understand it. As a former correction officer in this county and a survivor of domestic violence, there are laws that have to be changed. That is not any fault of your own or the teachers or administrators, but that burden is being placed upon them to be able to deal with what the courts are not dealing with. And that burden is being placed upon our teachers and our administrators. So I respectfully ask for the additional funding for our teachers and the administrators. Thank you for your time.
Sarah Penrod, and following Sarah will be Greg Armstrong.
Good evening. I'm sorry if I stutter through this a little bit. I decided to go off script this evening to better follow up some of the comments that my colleagues have made this evening. But it should be okay. I'm a teacher. This is what I do, changing the lesson plans on the fly. My name is Sarah Penrod. This is my 8th year teaching Spanish at Choptacon High School. But teaching Spanish is only part of what I do there. I am one of the advisors for the only remaining chapter of Future Business Leaders of America in St. Mary's County Public Schools. I also sponsor the Gay Straight Alliance at Choptacon. I am a mentor teacher for new teachers and intern teachers, and I am an East MIC building rep. I love being busy. My husband might disagree, but it's what I do. I love what I do. Unfortunately, I just don't think I'm going to be able to do anything but teach next year. The problem is I'm looking at class sizes of 41 next year. We're looking at 500 students, Spanish students at Choptacon for 2 teachers. What happened was 2 years ago, we lost one of our Spanish teachers to retirement, and of course, there wasn't enough funds to replace her. So the last couple of years, we've been stealing Margaret Brent's Spanish teacher to teach several classes at Choptacon. This year, she's teaching 4. Yet my class sizes are still topping out at 32. She's retiring this year. We have no idea what's going to happen if we're replacing her at Margaret Brent, and if we do, are we going to be able to use her at Choptacon? So all we have to go off of is what we know now. We have 500 Spanish students and 2 Spanish teachers. That's 250 students per teacher, 41 students in a class. I only have 32 desks in my room, and we don't have the budget to buy more. So what I'm asking you is to please fund the school budget so that we can hire not just another Spanish teacher, but all of the staff that we need. Because in the end, the only thing it hurts is the students. Because how fair is it for those children to be in classes of 41 people? Thank you.
Greg Armstrong. Following Mr. Armstrong will be Diane Rukavina, I believe it is.
My name is Greg Armstrong. Thank you for the opportunity to speak this evening. I support education and everyone here this evening who has spoken on its behalf. I am here to talk about the Academy of Visual and Performing Arts. Research shows that an education in the arts can enhance academic achievement, social and emotional development, civic engagement, teamwork, creative thinking, and problem solving. My son is a junior at Chopticon, and while he is not in the AVPA, he has benefited greatly from the experiences that the small number of devoted AVPA educators provide for all CHS students. He has enjoyed individual and shared successes in Ms. Lynn's band program that have bolstered his confidence. In addition, he has played for musicals put on by Ms. Blewett and the theater department represented here this evening, during which he has also been influenced by the artistic contributions of Ms. Lorick, Ms. Karnbach, and their vocal and orchestral students. It is important to note that for every hour put in by students preparing for a performance, the educators put in too. Instructors and performers work together in groups, big and small, to create something greater than themselves for everyone in the community to enjoy. My son and his classmates, as well as hundreds of thousands of students across the country, are the next great musicians, photographers, singers, actors, dancers, painters, and technicians of the stage and studio, professionals and amateurs who will influence and be influenced by the world around them deep into the 21st century. The need to identify, reward, and retain their instructors cannot be overstated. A broad education in the arts allows us to identify how to best communicate our innermost thoughts and feelings. The best gifts we give and receive are those that were created for us and by us, and the arts make that possible. Our relationship with the arts is reciprocal in that our appreciation and understanding of the arts mature with experience, driving further creativity. Artistic skills can continue to grow for our entire lifespan, unlike in many disciplines. The works of painter Grandma Moses, musician B.B. King, and actress Jessica Tandy show how experience can enhance innate talents.
30 seconds.
There is much more that could be said about photographs that have altered the course of world events, the music and choreography in West Side Story, or Cameron staring at Seurat's painting at the Art Institute of Chicago, but my time is short. I'd like to thank arts teachers everywhere for making all of these things and more possible. I hope that each of you does what you can to see that the AVPA staffing and funding levels are increased to provide more opportunities for expression, collaboration, and celebration. Please continue to fund the arts and education, and thank you for your support.
Diane Rukavina, and following Diane is going to be Ricky Rice.
My name is Diane Rukavina, and my son is a second-year cadet in the Junior ROTC. I'm here to speak about funding the third instructor for the Junior ROTC program. When there is a decision to be made, there is an emotional side of the decision and the practical side. I'd like to first address the emotional side. The Junior ROTC program is important, not just to Great Mills, but to St. Mary's County. These high school students are on the verge of becoming the adults who will be residents of this county, and the Junior ROTC program produces good citizens. Citizens who will give back to their county in positive ways. Some will join our great military, some will be police or firefighters, and some may be the future elected officials. Captain Randall and First Sergeant Hamm are good men who work 6 or 7 days a week to support this program and these cadets. The students of Great Mills are proud of their ROTC. They cheer them for pep rallies the same way they cheer for their sports teams. The Junior ROTC is a positive symbol to Great Mills, and they are a positive example to their fellow students, and Great Mills needs them. But maybe you can't factor emotion into this decision, so here's the practical side. In November, when we go to elect a new board of county commissioners, as county commissioners, you are elected to represent the residents of St. Mary's County. If you do not fund the third instructor, you will be breaching a contract with the Navy. They will remove this program, and it will go to another high school in another state.
I don't want to be represented by someone who is willing to break a contract with the Navy. And this would be a terrible thing for St. Mary's County. I know I have just one vote in November, and maybe that one vote doesn't mean much to you. But standing behind me are the cadets and the parents of the junior ROTC, and that's hundreds of votes. And standing behind them are the students and parents of Great Mills High School, and that's thousands of votes. Because this program is important to Great Mills, it's important to St. Mary's County, and it will be important in how we cast our votes in November. Thank you.
Ricky Rice. Calling Mr. Rice will be Karen Richardson.
Good evening. Good evening, Commissioners. I'm going to kind of ad-lib this a little bit. I want to applaud all the teachers, students, and anybody else who stood up to talk about education. You know, education is very important. I am a Choptank graduate. Played 3 sports. Went on to coach baseball at Choptank for 15 years, 4 years as a head coach. In 2014, I retired. My daughter, as a 7th grader, became part of the band at Choptank as a 7th grader. In 2016, I became Band Booster President. So my point here is I'm seeing both sides of the spectrum here. Funding has never really been too much of an issue on the athletic side. But when I became Band Booster President, I realized that the band and a lot of the visual arts don't get a lot of funding at all. The one thing that didn't make any sense to me, parents had to pay fees for students to participate in band. Keep in mind, it's a class. They don't have to pay fees to play baseball. The reason being, there's no funding there for that. And I just couldn't fathom that, how a class costs money at the high school level. So something that I wish you guys would think about was maybe start funding this budget. Maybe we can get some funds in here for the visual arts program, the band programs. You know, one of the biggest issues we have too is some of these parents can't afford to put their kids in band. We, as boosters, try to supplement that. But it's hard because we're going to businesses and everybody else constantly looking for money. I am a business owner. I get hit from every side of the spectrum. And it's tough because when they see me coming, they know I'm asking for money. And it's tough on all of us as parents and volunteers. So please keep this in mind. You know, it's bad when you have to rent an instrument at school, but you don't have to rent a football helmet. So keep that in mind.
30 seconds.
Thank you.
Karen Richardson. And following Karen will be Melinda Tracy.
Good evening. My name is Karen Richardson. I'm a STEM teacher at Lexington Park Elementary. I have a computer engineering degree, and before returning to school to earn my master's degree, I programmed Trident submarines. A tidbit here, my starting salary as an engineer in 1985, having only a bachelor's degree and no work experience, was the exact same as my starting salary as a teacher in 2000. And I had a master's degree and a year of teaching experience. I find it sad that some in the St. Mary's County community value teachers so little. Yes, I know switching jobs would involve a pay cut, but I have always wondered why my job as an engineer was valued so much more than my job as a teacher. Yes, I only work 10 months a year, but I'm not paid 10/12 of what I would make as an engineer. Why, I ask, do we, St. Mary's County, not value education? Lip service is given. Yeah, we value education. We support education, you all say. But for some of you, your actions do not reflect your talk. You are not walking the talk. Why, when St. Mary's County is the sixth wealthiest in the state of Maryland, when it's been shown that we do have the money, why is our per pupil spending one of the worst in the state? I implore you to take action and show that you value education and fund the Board of Education's modest request. Thank you.
Melinda Tracy, and following Melinda will be Tammy Payne.
Hi, my name's Melinda Tracy. I'm a teacher in St. Mary's County and I live in Mechanicsville. This is my 43rd year of teaching. I'm in it because I love students, but I am seeing students suffer now. To read in the paper that special education for elementary students should have a ratio of one special ed teacher for 250 students, and then be cut a special education teacher, 650 students in a building, two special ed teachers. Doesn't do the math doesn't work. State staffing ratios for special education teachers should improve. It's not just the number of students, it's the hours, it's the services, it's the needs of the special education students or other students, especially those with behavior concerns. If we can take care of some of the behavior in pre-K, kindergarten, and first grade, it might not spread as far as it has. So please fund the full budget to include counselors, psychologists, and special education teachers. Mr. Smith knows what he's doing. Thank you.
Tammy Payne, and following Tammy will be Colin Maher.
Good evening, I'm Tammy Payne, and I'm speaking on behalf of myself. I am an educator, but that's not why I'm here. I'm also a 56-year-old woman that likes to play on Facebook. And I really wish the commissioners would play fair. I am embarrassed, and you should be too, by how one of your commissioners has treated this entire issue on Facebook. I have it up if you would like to see. If you would like his quotes, I have that as well. Mr. John O'Connor said, and I quote, when he says on SOMDnews.com that he's running for a second term, there is so much more to do in support of our school system. But on March 16th, Commissioner John O'Connor, and he named himself as commissioner, said the school board spending is all capitals, which if you're not aware means that he's shouting out of control. Which one is it? He also went on to quote other people and said, oh yes, I'm sure they're gonna try. Let's see if they can load the room. Thank you, we did.
Colin Maher, and following Colin will be Elfrida Mathis.
Hello, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. My name is Colin Maher, and I'm a 12th grader at Choptank High School, and I'm a part of the Academy of Visual Performing Arts. The program started my freshman year and has been supported by the school system throughout the years. Through my arts career in school, starting in the third grade and continuing to now, I've been able to express myself, gain life skills, and demonstrate leadership all because of the arts. I feel strongly that the art and our education needs to be funded sufficiently. Students, staff, and families that are part of the arts are passionate about it, myself included. We who have the desire to perform and create seem also to be those who perform well in our other academic classes. We learn time management, maturity, and even how to stand and speak in front of people. The arts being funded and our schools being funded means dreams being funded. Our future artists and leaders being funded, our community being funded, our passions being funded. It is difficult for a student to show their true potential and talent if they are restricted because of the lack of tools they need. The money provided will help us grow and show our true potential. Concerts, performances, and art exhibits in the schools have always had a packed audience, even in middle school and elementary schools. And they are not just family members and friends watching. They are interested community members that support our youth's dreams, aspirations, and talents. I plan to teach theater in life so later on so that I can bring the same joy, desire, and excitement to someone's life that is brought to mine. By having this staff, friends, and school system that supports me in what I do now and what I'm going to do has helped me tremendously. I am just one of the many, but I feel your support will help the others and the future of generations of artists and students gain more knowledge and the ability to shine in their full potential. I ask that you raise the school education budget, not so that it's under the 1%, but maybe 4%. And if you think that's funny, then we can compromise, meet in the middle, and let's say the 2% that we thought we were going to get. And even at that, set aside and add money for financial support for the fine arts in our community and in our schools. I personally pay $20 for every theater class that I take in my school. I take three. That's $60 right there. My chorus class is $60 for uniform and art and the music fees. I pay $120 a year to go to my high school when I have the right for my education, and I'm told it is a free education. And I do the math in my head, and I wonder the money that you give to our school system now. If you divide that up between the people getting paid and the maintenance in our schools, if I am paying more for my education when it should be free. So the arts and the schools can provide many jobs and simply bring happiness to a person's life. The arts surround us, and I ask that you support our system the way our school system do. And I'm 18, so I can vote this coming November, and whether or not this changes decides my vote. Thank you.
Elfrida Mathis, and following Elfrida will be Julia Davis.
Good evening, commissioners. Thank you for your service. I had a prepared speech, but first, to the audience, I'm a retired educator of 35 years, St. Mary's County Public Schools. When I started teaching in 1967, the first year of full desegregation in St. Mary's County Public Schools, I made $6,000 a year. My first budget hearing was 1968, and I doubt if I probably made 90% of the budget hearings for the rest of my career. And I hate to tell you, folks, but enough of you haven't said anything that wasn't said in 1968, okay? And I think, commissioners, some advice to you. The Board of Education are elected officials. Please listen to them. If they actually ask you for what they needed, you'd be under the table. So it's just a small piece of the pie that they come and ask for every year. And as an educator who've done this 100 times over, In my school career, the biggest issue to me was, why do I have to go crawling and begging and snatching for funds for a career that I love, that I knew that I was not going to be a millionaire in the outcome, that I'd make a decent living? I'm in a community that is matched up between engineers and base people making $80,000 a year, average income, versus what educators and school people make. But the level of spending more matches what the $80,000 people make than one what minute. Educators make. 1 minute, oh my God. Well, I came because we need a new volunteer fire and rescue squad building for the 2nd and 9th districts. And it's the only combined fire and rescue building in St. Mary's County. And the status alone is a standalone cost savings. The current building was built 57 years ago in 1961 and has undergone 6 renovations. What does that take? Are we ready for something new?
30 seconds.
As principal of Lexington Park Elementary School, that building was renovated after 50 years. We need something new. And that's a perfect example of some people in the community that don't want to go move into the future because we don't have the money. We have the money for anything that we want. So please look at the total community and serve us well. Thank you.
Julia Davis, and following Julia will be Hannah Davis.
Good evening. My name is Julie Davis, and I've taught in the state of Maryland for 28 years this coming October. I'm here tonight to implore our commissioners to do the right thing by funding a school budget that provides quality services. This past year, the state of Maryland took on the noble mission of keeping more of our tenuous students in school every day. This meant that kids whose needs could not be managed in the classroom were kept in school for programming that might modify the students' behavior, motivations, and outcomes for learning. This noble mission is what every servant in our schools would want for our students. Yet, with no specific funding, schools have had to absorb these students and their specific complexities in the daily schedule of school. And I'm here to tell you that this cannot be done without the proper resources. Counselors, psychologists, social workers, and medical personnel are the services we need for these learners. Interventions, by definition, require resources for action to prevail and change the course of a student's life. We have so little of these interventions for measurable success. Currently, my middle school has two counselors for 1,000 students. Our psychologist is now available to us when needed, as opposed to being regularly scheduled, along with the loss of a pupil personnel worker on a regular basis. This leaves us with a subpar situation at best. Please give us these resources to intervene in our students' well-being. By investing in these proactive measures, we're helping our community members make positive changes in their lives. The police and security officers also have significant roles in the schoolhouse, but I would rather our superheroes in schools be clad with the wisdom to enhance social-emotional growth and overall well-being. Less than this, we watch the therapeutic goals of our students slide into a relationship with the courts and, dare I say, prisons. Fund our schools, please. Thank you.
Hannah Davis, and following Hannah will be Tema Schlesinger.
Hello, my name is Hannah Davis, and I'd just like to preface my remarks by saying that I have to go write an essay after this, so I'll try to keep it brief. I'm here on behalf of my school, my peers, and the future students of St. Mary's County Schools. I want to address our commissioners about why it is so important to drastically increase our investment in our schools and our students. I myself am a part of the Global International Studies program at Leonardtown High School and have seen the benefits of such an enhanced course of study in my life. Our academy places an emphasis on studying the implications of cultures and ideas all around the globe. Just last semester, I wrote an essay about why increasing funding in our schools is essential to preparing a global community capable of meeting the challenges of the future. Without this academy and its necessary funding, I would be sitting in a class that would not exist, with friends I would not have met, learning about a topic I would not have been aware of. Without increased funding in my school or others around the county, the quality of our classes and the opportunities given to our students will suffer. I implore you to consider the students and want to remind you all that our proposed budget today determines how we prepare the future leaders of tomorrow.
Tema Schlesinger, and following Tema will be Karen Schlesinger.
Good evening, my name is Tema Schlesinger, and I'm a sophomore at Leonardtown High School.
Our schools are our secondary homes. Within them, we are nurtured, influenced, and molded into bright, intellectual young adults who have the potential to bring so much charisma into the workforce. Not only that, our schools are nurturing higher income taxpayers who can bring so much prosperity to our county. And this can only be done through better allocation of necessary funds, especially to teacher pay. My teachers are responsible for my ability to speak before you today with confidence, and they deserve the salaries that reflect the incredible influence they have on generations. Unfortunately, the characteristics that the most incredible teachers have, such as passion and dedication, cannot always pay their bills. I have already lost an incredible teacher to a private school because of better pay. I hope to never lose such a formative relationship like that again simply because of money. And I find it absolutely ridiculous that teachers must ask for tissues, something as simple as tissues, because the school can't provide them. So I request an increase in budget so that students can have the teachers that they need. Thank you.
Karen Schlesinger, and following Karen will be Marcia Greenberg.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you. My name is Karen Schlesinger, and I'm a parent and a business owner in Leonardtown. I moved here almost 4 years ago due to an employment change for my husband, who now works at St. Mary's College of Maryland. Before accepting his position, we did a lot of research on schools for our children. That was the primary factor deciding where we would move. 25 years ago, we had left DC for Montgomery County just to get to the excellent schools there, and we wanted to assure continued opportunities for our kids. Our daughter had been in a stellar performing arts magnet middle school. And in addition, she excels in language arts and has a passion for world justice issues. We initially looked in Calvert County because of their higher rated schools, but we found that the traffic going across the bridge was intolerable. Apparently, a lot of people earn their money in St. Mary's County and take it across the bridge. After talking to a few locals, though, we learned that Leonardtown High School has a global international studies program that is highly rated, and they achieve a high level of performance in their theater and music programs as well. So we made an investment in St. Mary's County. And now I'm asking you to make an investment to keep our schools competitive. An investment in our schools should be part of our marketing plan to attract families with higher incomes who value their children's public education and to keep them in the county. The STEM program also connects our brightest youth with internships and eventually jobs on the base, which keeps them in the county when they graduate. This all results in higher tax revenues. So invest in the schools and invest in the county.
1 minute.
Thank you.
Marcia Greenberg. Following Marcia will be, looks like, Karen Breslauer.
Good evening, commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you this evening, as I have in other cases. I find myself in an odd situation because everybody who has spoken thus far speaks to a topic that I'm here to speak to as well. We are all here to speak to the issue of investing in young people. I am here to represent the steering committee of a campaign for a community youth center, as you all know. That campaign should be something in addition to what the schools offer. And it is astonishing to me that we are spending all of this time talking about proper schools when we have so much more to do as well. So I would like first to endorse wholeheartedly what has been said here in terms of proper funding of the schools. But as you know, the schools, Superintendent Smith and I have talked about this, are responsible for teaching students during certain hours within certain parameters. But our young people in this county need more investment than that. When they leave school, they still need more support. We've heard about the arts at Choptank. but there are children throughout this community and young people who also want to invest in the arts and to learn about them. We have heard about the sporting programs. That's fine, but we also need more. We ask you, the Campaign for a Community Youth Center, and people here with their buttons are showing their support for such a center. We ask you, please, let's go beyond just talking about dollars and cents. Let's start with what's really important. Commissioner Smith began by talking about an investment in young people. We all know that's important. Every single one of you knows that's important. We're not having a debate here. The question is, what are we going to do about it? And I'm asking you, on behalf of the campaign, please go beyond managing money to leading. Stand for something in this community. Tell people in this community and tell the voters in November that you are concerned about young people. We do not just want a building as a community center. A building is not enough, just as a house is not a home. That building has to have programs in it. And 2022, to begin the planning for a building is different than begin the planning for young people and what goes into that center. We urge you not only to fund the schools, but to fund additional programs for young people and for their families, for their afternoons, their weekends, and their overall enrichment. Thank you.
Is that Karen or Carol?
Karen.
Okay, Karen Breslauer, and following Karen will be Bart Ludlow.
Hi, I've been a parent in St. Mary's County Public Schools for the last 12 and a half years. We came here with the Navy, and the quality of the schools was a big part of our decision to stay here after my husband retired from active duty. These schools are filled with dedicated teachers, administrators, and support staff who show up every day to educate our children. Please reevaluate your proposed funding of the Board of Education budget. The Board of Education has requested new positions that are significant as our community continues to grow. We need more guidance counselors, another safety and security assistant, a junior ROTC instructor, and all the other positions that have been requested. The Evening High School and the High Roads programs can help ensure that children are continuing their education in the best environment for them. I spent many years in the schools volunteering on behalf of my children. We need to educate our students, we need to keep them safe, and prepare them to become productive members of society. Funding these positions can make that difference. We are 19th in Maryland for per pupil funding with one of the highest local tax rates. Worcester County has the highest per pupil funding in the state at $18,312 with a local income tax rate of 1.75%. St. Mary's County per pupil funding is $14,055 with a local income tax rate of 3%. It's a difference of $4,257 per student, and that's a lot of tax revenues. How is it possible that St. Mary's County is projecting a fairly flat funding for next year? With all the recent commercial growth, ongoing residential construction, coupled with a relatively low unemployment rate of 4.4%, it doesn't seem to make sense. Your budget states you're using the income tax revenues from the last 3 years for your projections, yet it also notes that the 2016 returns that were used in these calculations were lower than projected. You're projecting a 3.5% increase in income tax, but your proposed budget says we'll continue to monitor the payments that are received in fiscal 18, which are currently 4% higher. When are you going to stop monitoring and start acting? As you may be able to tell, my background's in accounting, and sometimes these numbers don't seem to add up. You're called upon to meet the needs of many constituents. We expect you to keep taxes low and keep a tight rein on your budget. To be perfectly honest with you, my youngest son is a senior in high school this year. It'd be very easy for me to say that this is no longer my problem, but I've seen too many groundbreaking changes that have taken place since he started here in 2005. I've seen the expansion of full-day kindergarten, more paraeducators, we have the academies, Fairlead 1 and 2, new elementary schools, and more supports in place. Please,
time.
Thank you.
Bart Ludlow, and following Mr. Ludlow is Sam Starkey.
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm here on behalf of St. Mary's Little League. And one of the things I was kind of perplexed was, I know there's a new $5 participation fee that they're going to charge recreation parks on all registrations starting in July. And it didn't get a hearing. So I'm just here to request one, that you actually put it back on the docket maybe for next year so that there can be a hearing and have a lot more of the sports organizations have an opportunity to express their concerns. I was at the advisory hearing that they had a couple months back. I did express that or ask why the purpose of it. They had mentioned that it had to do with park safety. And at that time, I recommended to them, as I do to you this evening, that the safety of our parks is a community issue and it should be handled from the general revenue perspective rather than have a $5 fee on all the sports youth activities. So with that, that's all I have for this evening. Thank you.
Sam Starkey. Following Sam will be Mary Ann Grenat.
Hi, I'm Sam. I'm a teacher at Margaret Brent Middle School here, but I'm reading tonight from a student that attends our school. Commissioners, I am a student at Margaret Brent Middle School. I am currently in eighth grade, if that means anything to you. But to me, it means that I have only 4 more years to be fully prepared for the real world. I am well-versed in many things for my age, but I know that I am not yet ready for what the world has to offer me. I am not ready because I am a student with a learning disability, and yes, it comes with a stigma, but I am one of the students in your county that gets 4s and 5s on park, so don't let that fool you. That said, I look to my teachers and the staff in my building to help guide me and set examples. I also look toward individuals such as yourselves who show that when push comes to shove, we should always do what's in the best interest of the children who will one day run our country. I know that what we are asking for seems like a lot and that you are unsure of how to maintain the continuous budget for these jobs. Not only are these jobs vital to our success as a school district and a county, but they are vital to the success of our country. Many of the students that I attend school with have parents that work on the military base, mine included. Thanks to my parents' education and their ability to get jobs on that military base, we are in the higher wage bracket, which means that we have a higher tax bracket, which also means that we bring money back to our schools and our county. In fact, my goal is to work on base and to have my salary be taxed and contribute back to the education that I have received from St. Mary's County Public Schools. Without a proper education and a strong supportive staff that focuses on not just my academic growth, but my physical and emotional well-being, I would not be able to reach my goal and contribute back to the county that has given me so very much. I may not know much, but I am learning, and what I do know is that I like to problem solve. If money is the issue here, then let's grant at least 6 positions for grant writers who can help get money for our county and public schools. If you hired 6 grant writers for $60,000 a year, that would be $360,000. Now, yes, we would have to give that money back to them every year, but imagine how much those 6 positions could obtain if their full focus was on grants just for our schools and county. Since I have autism, we are symbolized by puzzle pieces. Right now, I feel as though you are only looking at one small piece of the puzzle. So I ask that you look at the bigger picture. If you put this one piece into the puzzle, we will have a beautiful finished picture for our county. You hold that piece in your hands, and you have the ability to either finish the puzzle or leave it empty and unfinished. Your decision will forever impact me and my classmates. Sincerely, a very concerned middle school student.
Mary Ann Granada, and following Mary Ann will be Andy Guys.
Thank you. Good evening. I hope that you are here because you believe, as I do, that an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. So I want you to write down what I'm about to say. Do you have a pen? I'm prepared. Excellent. You need to write down, fund the superintendent's budget. Did you get that? Write that down. Fund the superintendent's budget. It's getting long, it's getting late, and I see some blank stares. But students learn by doing. It's a simple philosophy in education. It's called Bloom's Taxonomy. And the wonderful 2,000 educators who educate the 18,000 plus students each day do that. They have these students engaged by doing, by creating, and they're creating knowledge. So what is the lesson for today? Excellent. Which budget? I want to know which budget. The superintendent's budget. Thank you.
All right, Andy Guys. Following Andy will be Jill Morris.
Good evening, I'm here representing a group, Southern Maryland Community Resources.
Okay, 5 minutes.
And I have with me another member of the board, executive director as well here. We've been in business as a nonprofit for approximately 5 years now. Okay. And during that time frame, we've been able to establish programs here in St. Mary's County that address people with special needs, particularly those who are aging out of the educational system. We've heard a number of people talk about that this afternoon. Thank you. We've heard a number of people talk about that this afternoon, where we're having people with special needs having not having enough funds, not having enough availability to do the things that they need to do. So we're here to provide programs that help people as they age out of that. When they do age out, we see a real cliff in what's available for people. Those programs just simply go away. And by using a nonprofit organization and getting some funding from the county government to support that, we're able to multiply that small amount of money that comes from the county government and use the donations that we get from a variety of people throughout the community to be able to provide programs that include them in the mainstream. We're looking at programs where they can contribute their own unique talents and abilities, and they can develop their abilities to work with others in the mainstream community. So with the small amount of money that we get from the county government to do that, we can really be a force multiplier to provide excellent programs for these individuals. And these individuals need that ability because without those kind of programs, we see many poor outcomes develop here. What we start to see is poor health habits being formed. We start to see poor social habits being formed. We're seeing isolation. These are the things that we're trying to absolutely avoid and trying to bring people into an inclusive community. Bonnie, would you like to say something?
Thank you. My name is Bonnie Elwood, and I'm the executive director for Southern Maryland Community Resources. As Andy said, we have been here for almost 5 years in July, and we have inclusive programs. We like to emphasize the word inclusive. It's really important for our young people who have special needs or developmental differences to be able to interact and have social skills, being able to be with people who do not have developmental differences. There's two goals that happen for us when we do this. Those individuals who do not have developmental differences have a greater understanding of the needs of this particular community. These are our future leaders, these are our future CEOs, these are our future business owners. They will not hesitate to hire our individuals with developmental differences. Also, it allows our individuals' developmental differences to develop the social skills that are needed so that they can volunteer within our community and those who have the skill set be able to have employment within the community. We enjoy a wonderful partnership with all of the providers within the community, such as BACSS, SIL, the ARC, Center for Life Enrichment. These agencies really focus on a multiple facets such as coaching, job employment, volunteerism, whereas we really focus on the social, educational, recreational opportunities, which gives them the opportunity to be able to be inclusive within our community. Our request from you is very small in dollars, but I can assure you that the impact that it will have on this community for the quality of life for those individuals without developmental differences and those with developmental differences will make for us always the quality of life. We have very wonderful, innovative programs, and they're very creative. One of them were that we have just signed a memorandum of understanding with the St. Mary's County Public Schools is to be able to have community cadets with the JRTC program here at Great Mills High School. We thank you for the opportunity.
Hi. It's a pleasure to see you gentlemen, and thank you for your time. I'm Julie Randall, and I am the Vice President and right now Acting President of Southern Maryland Community Resources. I urge you to consider the proposal that we put forth this year to ask for a minimum amount of dollars, but we will match it with donations and make a huge impact on folks who have disabilities in social and recreational areas and programs. When you leave the school system, there ain't much out there for you. And we have tried to fill that gap, and I think we've done a really good job. We'll spend your money wisely, and thank you again.
Jill Morris, and following Jill will be Alexis Gray.
Hello, good sirs. I know it's the evening is getting late, but I am so proud of the educators, the students, the community members that came out tonight to speak with you. I'm Jill Morris. I'm the president of the Education Association of St. Mary's County. We ask people to come and show up to let you know that they're invested. Now, here's what we need from you. We need you to be our heroes. We need you to change your minds. We need you to fund the very modest request that has been pared down and looked at and talked about. You've seen me at all the meetings this year. We need you to change your minds and find a way to fund this budget, all the county budget. We are really counting on you to do the right thing. Thank you.
Alexis Gray, and following Alexis will be Melissa Willie.
Good evening. So I actually came, I'd like to say everyone here has said some amazing things, and the common theme I think is youth and how we need to invest in them. I'm actually here because I spend probably 90% of my time at a ball field when I'm not working. I have two kids, I coach. I've been coaching since before they were born. But a frustration that we have are the condition of our fields. And as someone who grew up in this place, I'm trying to provide great coaching, great opportunities for our youth. And I actually didn't realize there was this $5, I guess, maybe the proposal of the fee. And the reason why I came here and we found out about it is I'm trying to start a youth field hockey program. I'm a director of a club program, but we want to bring a rec program down here, and we were searching for fields. Not to school everyone in field hockey, but the surface is very important. And we couldn't find a decent field that we are allowed to play on. Bermuda grass, you know, just simple care of the fields that we have. I actually support a $5 fee if it's going to invest back into the fields that we have. I know there's a proposal for a great athletic complex, but that will be probably built by the time my kids graduated, you know, high school. So I'd like to see something done now. And if this fee goes into maintaining and improving what we have, I say go for it. I mean, we are trying so hard. We have over 100 kids interested in this program, and we just can't find a place to put these kids. We're not allowed on the fields at Chancellor's. They use those for games and for soccer. And so we're trying to start a new program here, and just we can't get our footing. We have the people, we have the expertise. I have an Olympian who wants to help coach us. You know, like we're excited about, you know, starting this program, and whatever we can do to improve these fields, you know, please, let's do it. And if I'm willing to pay the $5 per kid, I have kids in all kinds of sports right now. But if we can invest in these fields, I'd really appreciate it.
Melissa Lilly. Following Melissa will be Lisa Blattenberger.
Hello. So I'm Jalen Willie's mom. I am here, I'm passionate about the kids' education. I'm a mom of nine. I have eight that will be in St. Mary's County Schools. I will be around for a very long time. The denial for extra funding for schools, for books, for education, for JROTC, and the biggest one at this point, education and safety. I'm standing in a school right now that my daughter was shot in. Right now, right here. This boy walked into this school with a gun and he shot my daughter. And you all are denying funding for that safety. These other children and other families should never have to do what we are dealing with right now. The communication, the lack of communication on that day on March 20th, when I had no idea that my daughter was hurt, and I couldn't find out that my daughter was hurt until I got to Leonardtown 2 hours later. Not one phone call, not one person could pick up the phone or communicate with us and say, your child is the one that's hurt. You need to get here right now. The lack of communication was horrific. I encourage you guys, please go over your budget and give the school systems the money for funding. Please.
Lisa Blattenberger, and following Lisa will be Joshua McCoy.
Sorry. Good evening, County Commissioners. My name is Lisa Blattenberger, and I'm the Executive Director of Boundless Expectations. We provide specialized educational services throughout the county, actually throughout the Tri-County area, and through the state. Our center works with families when students struggle academically, most specifically due to learning challenges and differences. This provides me with a unique opportunity to also work closely with St. Mary's County Public Schools. In comparison to very large, very well-funded counties, St. Mary's County is at the top of the education list in Maryland. And I can tell you that firsthand because I do see these other wonderful counties not performing as well as ours. We need to continue to improve their ability to provide students with high quality instruction. We need to continue to provide new initiatives, programs, and training for our teachers. Not only is it essential we fund the county's funding request so we can appropriately staff our schools, provide critical programs, and allow us to improve safety and security. Not only are these essential to fund, but it is time to start making education a priority in this county. We need to better support our teachers. We need to make our children in public schools a priority. And we need to equip our teachers with appropriate tools to continue to tackle the education gap. Please at least fund the St. Mary's County Public Schools education budget request. Thank you.
Joshua McCoy, and following Joshua will be Bernice Elwood.
Good afternoon. My name is Joshua McCoy, and I'm the class president of the class of 2020 at Leonardtown High School. I come before you today to express my opinions of why we should not cut federal funding programs in terms of security in school. I speak on behalf of not just the students of Leonardtown, but of the schools of the county in which we live in. School is supposed to be a place where kids can go and learn to improve their minds. School is supposed to be a place of happiness and excitement, not fear. Kids should be able to come to school and not be afraid. School is supposed to be safe. The community has suffered a horrible incident almost a month ago, hoping that something like that will never happen again. We cannot cut school funding because without it, we cannot put forth money into security for our schools and to ensure the safety of our students to make school a place of pleasure. We are the leaders of the future, and education is key, but the safety of our students comes first. Please give us the funding we need to ensure that the students are safe. Thank you.
Bonnie Elwood. Is Bonnie here? Okay. All right, that concludes all the signed, the folks who've signed to speak on the FY 2019 recommended budget. If there's someone here who has not had the opportunity to speak and would like to, now would be the time to do so. With that said, I will close the FY 2019 recommended, one speaker. One additional speaker.
Greetings. My name is Dr. Timothy Azan. If you have trouble hearing me, it's because I can't hear out of my right ear at this point. My wife and I moved to this county back in September. We moved here because we heard that this was a great school system. I've been an educator for 20 years. I've served my country. I've been in ministry. I've worked in mental health. And I can tell you that you have a fracture. It's a stress fracture. It is something you're really going to have to take a look at. Just recently, I was hospitalized with a stroke. At the same time, abnormal arrhythmic action or arrhythmic in my heart. Recently diagnosed with Hashimoto's disease. My wife also got news this year that she has pulmonary sarcoidosis, which in the second stage, by some reports, she may not live longer than 10 years. We've devoted our lives to education. We've given our hearts and our minds. I've done everything I possibly can do for education. My parents, my grandfather is a World War II veteran. My father is a 26-year veteran. I can tell you about loyalty. I can tell you about commitment. I can tell you a lot of experiences I've had in education.
1 minute.
But I'll tell you what's the most important thing that parents tell me. Dr. Hazan, you've changed my life because you changed my child's life. I can tell you I've done that countless times in my career, and I don't want to stop. But I think my body's telling me something different now, and I'll tell you why. It's because, just as in the military, I've been given a task, but I've never been given the funding or the tools or the resources to do my job. And that's what I see here tonight. That's what all these people are asking. It's the same thing. How do you want me to do my job and change lives if you cannot give me the resources that I need to do my job? That's all I'm asking you. That's what you really need to do.
Time. Okay, is there anyone else who's not had an opportunity to speak and would like to do so? Now would be the time to do so. I'm looking around making sure nobody's coming from the side. All right. And with that said, I will close the FY 2019 recommended budget, the hearing on that, and close our proceedings for this evening. On behalf of the commissioners of St. Mary's County, we thank you all very much for the spirited conversation and for your attendance at tonight's proceedings. We ask that you please arrive home safely, and good evening.